الله تعالى وبركاته. الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله تبارك وتعالى عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وبارك وسلم تسليمًا كثيرًا كثيرًا. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ثم لآتينهم من بين أيديهم ومن خلفهم وعن أيمانهم وعن شمائلهم ولا تجد أكثرهم شاكرين. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: إن الشيطان يجري من الإنسان مجرى الدم، أو كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. اللهم سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم، ولا فهم لنا إلا ما فهمتنا إنك أنت الجواد الكريم. اللهم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. اللهم ربنا زدنا علما، اللهم اجعلنا من الذين يستمعون القول فيتبعون أحسنه، أولئك الذين هداهم الله وأولئك هم أولو الألباب. اللهم اجعل اجتماعنا هذا اجتماعا مرحوما، وتفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما، ولا تجعل فينا ولا منا ولا معنا شقيا ولا محروما. آمين يا رب العالمين. وبعد، My dear respected brothers, elders and sisters in Islam, Alhamdulillah, we discuss before last week the importance of having sincerity in our a'mal, in our hasanat, in our good deeds. And today I will go over some of the traps of shaitan, because we do hasanat, mashallah, many times, but most of the time we also lose them as well. As ulama have mentioned clearly, that the great deal is not there when you do a good deed, when you do a good hasana, but the great deal is that when you save that hasana on your account till the day of Qiyamah. Because shaitan is with us and shaitan is after us every single moment. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Inna shaitana yajri min al-insani majra dami." That the shaitan runs in our body like the blood runs in our body. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, ثُمَّ لَآتِيَنَّهُمْ مِنْ بَيْنِ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمِنْ خَلْفِهِمْ وَعَنْ أَيْمَانِهِمْ وَعَنْ شَمَائِلِهِمْ وَلَا تَجِدُ أَكْثَرَهُمْ شَاكِرِينَ. The shaitan also challenged Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that, "Ya Allah, you have kicked me out of the paradise and your curse is upon me, but I will not leave your slave alone. I will not leave this insan, this human being alone. But I will attack them from their right side, from their left side, and from their top and from their bottom. I will leave no space or nowhere except that I will go after insan." So we have to be very careful. MashaAllah, we are almost in the beginning of 2021. The whole year is, you know, the whole year is after us. We have many intentions that inshallah we do many hasanat. Let these hasanat be only and only for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and not, you know, be a prayer in the hand of shaitan or of shaitan inshallah. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also mentions in a hadith that inna shaitana dhi'bul insan. The shaitan is the wolf, or is the wolf of insan. Like there is a wolf of goats Shaitan is also the wolf of insan. It tries to hunt. It tries to go after those who are single out, who are not with the jama'at, with the majority of the Muslim. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ ذِئِبُ الْإِنسَانِ كَذِئِبِ الْغَنَمِ يَأْخُذُ شَاتَ الْقَاسِيَةَ وَالنَّاحِيَةَ فَإِيَّاكُمْ وَالشَّعَرِ وَعَلَيْكُمْ بِالْجَمَاعَةِ فَإِنَّ يَدَ اللَّهِ مَعَ الْجَمَاعَةِ Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, do not stay alone. Stay with the majority, with the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because if you were to stay alone, you're more likely to fall prey in the hands of Shaytan. Also, Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, the hadith is narrated in Sahih Muslim, that إِنَّ الرَّجُلَ لَيَعْمَلُ زَمَنَ طَوِيلًا بِعَمَلِ أَهْلِ الْجَنَّةِ ثُمَّ يُخْتَمُ لَهُ عَمَلَهُ بِعَمَلِ أَهْلِ النَّارِ Allah, Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that many times the insan will do hasanat after hasanat. But at the very end of his life, he commits a sin and he becomes from the people of Jahannam. And then he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, وَإِنَّ الرَّجُلَ لَيَعْمَلُ زَمَنَ طَوِيلَ بِعَمَلِ أَهْلِ النَّارِ ثُمَّ يُخْتَمُ لَهُ عَمَلُهُ بِعَمَلِ أَهْلِ الْجَنَّةِ And there are some people who are doing throughout their whole life the a'mal, the deeds of Ahli Jahannam. The deeds of the people of hellfire. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides them at the very last stages of their life, and they do some hasanat and end up in Jannah, in paradise. We need to make dua. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes us among the second category of the people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes us among those who do a good deed and then end up in Jannah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not make us among those who do evil deeds and then end up in Jahannam. Imam Al-Zahabi rahmatullah alayhi, Imam Al-Jawzi rahmatullah alayhi, also Imam Abu Al-Lays Al-Samarqandi rahmatullah alayhi, both of them have mentioned a little story. Inshallah we conclude on this. They mentioned this story about a man from Bani Israel. And keep in your mind, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam clearly stated that حدثوا عن بني إسرائيل فلا حرج فيه. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that you can mention the stories of Bani Israel and there's no harm in it. So you might see, mashallah, I try to bring a hadith or two, a story from Bani Israel, because there are many lessons from their nations and from their story and from their ummah. So there's no harm in it. Imam Al-Zahabi rahmatullah alayhi and Imam Al-Samarqandi rahmatullah alayhi, both of them, they mentioned this story of this man from Bani Israel. He was a very righteous man. He was a monk, he was a sheikh, he was imam. And the ulama says, he was such a great man and such a pious man that if he was to raise his hands, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would accept his dua. So people of the community, people of the town would always go to him whenever they find themselves in any difficulty. And this man was from those people, mashallah, who would perform sawm, fast during the day, and perform nafil salah during the night. However, they had to perform salah, they would perform salah in the night. So this monk, this alim, this sheikh, this abid, this zahid, for 60 years he performed ibadah. In one narration, for 70 years, he stayed in his temple, in his church, and he worshiped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala day in and day out. His name was Barsisa. Al-Zahabi rahmatullah alayhi mentioned this story in Talbis Iblis that one day a time of jihad came. So there were three brothers who decided to go out for jihad, to struggle in the path of Allah, to fight in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to establish the hukum of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But these three men, they had one sister. So they said, how can we go in jihad while we have a sister? Where would we leave our sister? So they talked to each other, and then all of a sudden they said, there's a way we can go out for jihad. And the only way is that we can leave our sister with the most pious man of the town, Barsisa. He's a Abid, he's a Zahid. So they went to him, these three brothers, taking this, request that we, we are planning to go out to establish jihad in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're planning to fight in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but the only thing that is holding us back is our sister. So would you look after our sister while we establish jihad? The Basir said, no. This is fitna. This is shaitan. How can I look after your sister? I am busy the whole day worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. During the night, I'm establishing salah. I don't have time for any of these things. Women are fitna for me. Take it away from me. So these three brothers, they went home with their sister. Later on, shaitan came. Shaitan came in the hearts of Barsisa, of this priest. So how can you do this? How can you be so selfish? Look after only your ibadah, only your good deeds. What if these people would not go out in jihad? Or if they were to go out in jihad and they leave their sister with someone else and something bad might happen to her? How can you let this happen? So the Barsisa decided, okay, whenever they come next time, I'll say, okay, I'll be the responsible for your sister. Az-Zahabi rahmatullah alayhi, he continued the story in Talbis Iblis, that next time when these three brothers went again in their bed, they said, Ya Shaykh, Ya Imam, Ya Abid, Ya Zahid, can you rethink? He said, okay, I'll take your sister, but only in one condition. And the condition is that I will not keep her in my temple. You should make a house away from the temple, a distance away. So she'll be over there and I'll be in my masjid, I'll be in my temple worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the brother said, MashaAllah, very good. This is a great favor for you. Quickly, they arrange a house, a close by of Barsisa's house, of Barsisa's masjid, of his temple. Az-Zahabi rahmatullah alayhi continues the story. He says that the brother, they came with their sister, they left her in a separate house away, from his temple. And Barsisa, what he would do, he would cook food and he would leave it outside of his church. And whenever this woman will get hungry, she would walk to the church and outside of the steps, she finds her food and she takes it to her home and she eats it. Later on, Shaitan came again to Barsisa. And he says that, how can you do this? How can you let this woman walk, this long distance, and she's coming to the temple? A lot of people are looking at her. This is haram, najais. You should not let this happen. Barsisa said, okay. He decided that from tomorrow, I will prepare the food and I will leave the food on her doorstep. Instead of my doorstep, I will leave it on her doorstep. Az-Zahabi rahmatullah alayhi said he did it for a while, for a few days he did this. Shaitan came again. And says, Ya Barsisa, how can you do this? She still has to open the door and come out and get the food. People might look at her. Something bad happened to her. You should be kind, take this food in her house and leave it on the table. Barsisa, after a while, he took the food inside the house, he left it on the table. He did it for a few while, few days passed. Az-Zahabi rahmatullah alayhi says that later on, Shaitan came again to Barsisa and he said, it's been a while, the brothers are in jihad, fi sabilillah, and there is nobody talk to her. Nobody to talk to her. She's all alone. How can you, leave her like that, abandoned? She's someone's daughter. She deserves a bit of entertainment. Az-Zahabi rahmatullah alayhi says that the next time he took the food and he asked her, how are you doing? And then Az-Zahabi rahmatullah alayhi says that they start talking, hi, hello, assalamu alaikum and everything, how are you? Unfortunately, we have this, our gatherings also, mashallah, in our shadis, in our marriages. It's very unfortunate that we say that na mihram, you know, hi, and say, you know, saying salam to aunties and this and that, it's haram, najayiz. If you have a na mihram, whether it is your community member or it is your aunt or whoever it is, it's haram. This is the dose of shaitan. Az-Zahabi rahmatullah alayhi says that he continued, he started talking to this lady for a few days, and the talk converted into a longer talk to the extent that one day he commits zina with her. Az-Zahabi rahmatullah alayhi says that later on, this woman became pregnant and she delivered the baby. And then Az-Zahabi rahmatullah alayhi says, this man, this Abid, Barsisa, became upset. And he said that, how can I answer his brothers whenever they will come back from jihad? I supposed to be looking out, looking after this woman, and I have committed this and that, and now there's a child also. So shaitan came in to the heart of the Barsisa again. He said that what you should do to save yourself from getting into a trouble on the hands of, this girl's or this woman's brother is to kill the child. So Barsisa, he went, he killed the child. And shaitan came again into the heart of this Abid, and he says that, you think that this woman will not tell his brothers whenever they come back that you have killed her child? She will keep quiet? How is it even possible? Kill her too. Az-Zahabi rahmatullah alayhi continues, and he says that he went the next day, he killed the woman also. And he buried both of them in one place. Later on, Az-Zahabi rahmatullah alayhi says that the brothers of this woman came to the church, to the temple of Barsisa, and they says that, Ya Shaykh, Ya Imam, how are you doing? And how about our sister? Where is she? We can't see her. We cannot see her around. Az-Zahabi rahmatullah alayhi says that this Barsisa, he told his mother, she fell sick. She became ill. And she passed away. And he acted up in a way that he was sad and everybody said. So the brother said, okay, Sheikh, Ya Imam, you did a favor for us. May Allah reward you for whatever you did. And they went home. Shaitan came in the dreams of all these three brothers the same night. And he showed them that your sister was not ill and she did not die. Rather, this man killed your sister. And you should go and ask. And such place, you should go and dig and you will find her grave. And there is a child buried next to her, which was the result of zina with this man. So these three brothers, whenever they woke up, one of them went to his brother, he said that I have seen this dream. The other one said, yes, I have seen the exact same dream last night. The third one said, I have seen exactly the same dream. Let's go again and ask Barsisa what really happened with our sister. So they went in their grill. They asked this man like in tough tone, that this time you have to tell us truth because this is what we have seen in our dreams. This is a strange dream. How can it, how is it possible that it's false while we all have seen the same dream? You should be true to us. But Caesar became scared. He says, yes, it is true. I did this, I did that, and I eventually killed the child and your sister. They went, they dug up the grave, they find this woman and they find the child next to him. So these three brothers, they became really upset and angry. They took this sheikh, this abid, to the king, to the ruler of the town, and said, this is what he did with our child, with our sister, while we are establishing jihad in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You should establish justice. So the king said, this man should be hanged. He should be crucified. He should be crucified till death. Az-Zahabi rahmatullah alayhi says that whenever the king ordered that he should be crucified, shaitan came again. He was on the suli. You know, he was about to be crucified. Shaitan came again, and now this time he came in the form of man. And he told Rasulullah that, you know, all of this that happened in your life, all this trouble, I was the one who brought this in your life. And now I am the only one who can save you. If you really want to be saved from death penalty, I am the one who can save you. Do you need my help? But Caesar was scared. He didn't want to lose his life. He said, okay. Just help me at this time. And then, you know, in his heart, Caesar said, I will go back to Allah and I'll make tawbah, you know. Shaitan said, okay, I'll help you. But you have to do only one thing to me. You have to establish sajda to me. Az-Zahabi rahmatullah alayhi said that Barsisa established, he made the sajda to Iblis, to Shaitan, just to save his life. And now look at this man from Bani Israel. 60 years of ibadat, 60 years of worship, and how he end up with double murder and with making sajda and shirk to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is why the ulama, the moral of the story is that we need to do a'mal, we need to do good hasanat. But let it be only for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let us not disclose our hasanat. As-Samarqandi rahmatullah alayhi mentioned in his book that one should hide his hasanat as he hides his evil deeds. None of us wants our bad deeds to be known in public. Similarly, none of us should disclose our good deed in public, because shaitan might come and corrupt our intention and waste our hasanah. We make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us tawfiq to do our hasanah and our good deeds and our a'mal only for him subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to please him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to stay away and cleanse our heart from riya and from all diseases of soul. Ameen ya rabbal alameen. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfir Allah li wa li sa'ir al muslimin min kulli dhanbin fastaghfiruhu innahu huwal ghafurur rahim. Especially this, inshallah.